Hello, this is Professor Jim A. Chin at California State University, Long Beach. In this video lesson today, we'll look at multiplication and division of rational expressions. Let's start with the definition. A quotient of two algebraic expressions is called a fractional expression. The key word here is fractional. For example, if I write down 2x over x minus 1, this would be called a fractional expression because we have two algebraic expressions written in terms of the unknown x. Another example would be y minus 2 divided by y squared plus 3. Again, both y minus 2 and y squared plus 3 are algebraic expressions in terms of the unknown y, and then we write it as a quotient of those two algebraic expressions. Try to come up with a few more examples yourself to see if you actually understand the definition of a fractional expression. Here I'm going to write down two more. For example, x cubed minus x divided by square root of x plus 1. Another example would be as simple as just a number on top and something more complicated on the bottom, like x squared minus 5x plus 6. All of these four are called a fractional expression. On the other hand, a rational expression is a fractional expression in which both the numerator and the denominator are polynomials. Notice the difference here is the rational expression. Both the numerator and the denominator are polynomial functions. With this definition in mind, which one of those four fractional expressions is not a rational expression? And the answer is this one, the third one, because the expression of square root of x plus 1 is not a polynomial. So here, we're going to focus on learning techniques to simplify rational expressions where the numerator and the denominator are polynomial expressions. In particular, we're going to look at the multiplication and division techniques. And in general, the reason why the rational expressions are easier to deal with is because we have systematic tools such as factoring to simplify polynomial functions. On the other hand, if an expression that involves square root or cube root or any sort of a power, then it becomes relatively harder to come up with a systematic tool to do that. Let's start with a very simple rule here. Recall that if we have an expression a times c divided by b times c, where a, b, c are just some sort of algebraic expressions that involves polynomials, then we can actually simplify it by canceling out the common factor of c to obtain the expression a divided by b. The only thing we have to be careful about is that the factor c is not equal to 0. Otherwise, we can safely cancel out the common factor of c to reduce it down to a over b. For example, if I give you the expression x squared minus 1 divided by x squared plus x minus 2, we want to do something similar, which means that we have to factor our expressions into a product and then look for common terms within those products. Okay, so on the top, I can use the rule of difference of two squares because I notice it's x squared minus 1 squared. And so recall the difference of a square's rule is that if you have something squared minus another thing squared, then we can write it as the first plus the second times the first minus the second. Here we have x squared minus the 1 squared, so I can write it as the first, which is x, plus the second, which is 1, times the first minus the second. And that's called the difference of two squares. On the bottom, we're going to use just a general factoring rule on the quadratic polynomial by looking for factors that multiplied to negative 2 and adds to positive 1. So my candidates will be 1 and 2 because I know 1 times 2 is going to be 2, but I need it to be a negative 2. And I needed to decide where I should put the negative sign because the factors have to add up to be positive 1. I know that I need to put the negative sign with the 1. So this gives me factor x minus 1 times x plus 2. Then we notice that the factor x minus 1 is common amongst those two. So by the rule that we've just stated above here, we can cancel out these common factor and reduce it down to x plus 1 divided by x plus 2. And there's nothing else that's in common between those two things. Therefore, that will be our final answer problem. Now we're ready to look at how to multiply rational expressions. The rule we're going to follow is the following. If we have a fraction a over b times another rational expression c over d, then we're simply just going to multiply the top portion, which is a and a c, and then multiply the bottom portion, which is b and a d together, and then write them as a single fraction like that. So let's look at an example next. Here we want to multiply two different fractional expressions. Well, the first one is x squared plus 2x minus 3 divided by x squared plus 8x plus 16. And the second rational expression is 3x plus 12 divided by x minus 1. Our first step in simplifying is always to try to break down each expression into its factored form, because we consider factor as kind of the building block of expressions. And you might want to do these separately on the side if you're not familiar with or not so quick on your factoring yet. But if you're very, very familiar with how to factor quadratic polynomials and linear polynomials, then go ahead and just do it in a problem. For the first piece right here, we look for factors that multiply to negative 3. And so potential factors will be 1 and a 3. We need to decide where to put the negative sign so that when you add those two factors, it would be equal to positive 2. So then you have to put the negative with the 1. That way, when you add those two numbers, you would get the positive 2 that's over here. So that gives us the first set of factors for the top portion of the first rational expression, which is going to be x minus 1 times x plus 3. For the second expression down here in the bottom, we have factors that multiply to 16 and adds up to 8. Well, there are actually multiple combinations of factors of 16. You can have 1, 16, you can have 2 and 8, you can have 4 and 4. But you need to add those two things so that it adds up to 8. So then it seems like 4 and 4 would be an obvious choice here. And it turns out that actually is a complete square in this problem anyways. So this actually factored down to x plus 4 and x plus 4. For the third expression over here, in the second fractional expression, we have 3x plus 12. It is a linear term, which so we can't really use the technique we've just done there, but you can look for simply just a common factor in between two terms. This is your first term, and this is your second term. What is actually in common between those two things? And is the number 3, because I noticed that 12 is 3 times 4. So both of these terms have a common factor of 3, so I can take that out. And the leftover from the first term would be x, and the leftover from the second term would be this 4. It's connected by the additional sign in between. On the bottom right here, it's already in its complete factor form, simply just x minus 1. So I'm just going to rewrite. For the second expression over here, we have 3 times x plus 4 divided by x minus 1. With the rules that we've just stated there, to multiply two fractions like that, we're simply just going to put all the top portions together and all the bottom portions together. So we're going to have 3 times x minus 1 and x plus 3 and x plus 4 on top. And notice that I always write the constant number first. And that's just because it's for readability, it makes it easier to read. There is no number on the bottom, so we don't have to worry about that. And then the order at which you write these linear factors, it's entirely up to you. I like to start with the smallest number, x minus 1, and then x plus 4, x plus 4. My next task is then to look for common terms like what we did in the previous question, and to cancel. So what's in common here? The factor x minus 1 appears in both top and bottom, so that out. The factor x plus 4 appears both in the top and the bottom, so I can cancel that out. And there's nothing else that's in common between the top and the bottom, so I have leftover 3 times x plus 3 on top divided by the leftover x plus 4 on the bottom. And this is in the complete simplified form, and that's how I'm going to leave my answer. To divide rational expressions, we're going to follow the rule here. If I have a rational expression a over b, I want to divide that by c over d, then what I'm going to do is to turn it into a multiplication problem, which we are familiar how to do now, by flipping the second expression. So the first expression is going to stay exactly the same, and we're going to turn it into a multiplication problem of the inverse of this thing. So we're just going to invert the positions of c and d. So now d goes on top and the c goes on the bottom. And that's called the multiplication by the reciprocal. We've inverted this problem into a multiplication problem, then we know how to do that because we've done a problem like that before, right? So that's just going to be a times d on top and b times c on the bottom. Let's look at an example next. So here I wanted to take x minus 4 divided by x squared minus 4 divided by the expression x squared minus 3x minus 4 divided by x squared plus 5x plus 6. Now you can start by simplifying each of those expressions into its factored form, and then do this inversion of multiplication by the reciprocal thing. Or you can do it first and then simplify from there. It's entirely up to you how you want to do that, depending on your preference. I'm going to do a kind of a combination of the two things. And I'm going to factor each of those expressions in its original position, and then rewrite the problem into a multiplication problem. So I noticed that here for this expression, it's going to be x minus 4 and x minus 1, because when I take the factor 1 and the negative 4, I get a negative 4, right? Let's multiply, you get negative 4, and you add those two things, you get negative 3. Factors for the x squared plus 5x plus 6, it's going to be 2 and a 3 here, because 2 times 3 is 6, and a 2 plus 3 is going to be 5. So I have x plus 2 times x minus 3. And for the first expression here, this is already in a linear factor form. No need to do any work there. This is, again, a difference of 2 squares, because I noticed that 4 is 2 squared. So this is x squared minus 2 squared, and x is the first, 2 is the second, so I'm going to have x plus 2 times x minus 2. Now, every single expression here is already in its complete factor form. Then I can turn this into a multiplication problem by multiplying the reciprocal of the second expression. So just carefully rewrite. The first portion stays exactly the same, but now in a completely factored form. So that's x minus 4 divided by x plus 2 times x minus 2. For the second expression, notice that we're going to turn this into a multiplication problem and then invert the positions of the top and the bottom. So this now, the top portion, becomes the denominator, which is x plus 1 times x minus 4. Bottom portion of the second expression here now goes to the top. And then once you've turned it into a multiplication problem, we're just going to simplify it like how we did it in the previous multiplication problem there. Straight across and simplify. Okay, you can even do those in its position. So x minus 4 is on top. There's one factor here and one factor there in the bottom. X plus 2 appears on the top and on the bottom. And that's pretty much it. Nothing else appears both in the bottom and the top. We have just on top x plus 3 left, and on the bottom x minus 2 times x plus 1. Notice that if you only have a single factor left, you don't need to use the parentheses around it. You could, but you don't have to. But this is going to be the final answer.